You know how sometimes you find a new way of doing something familiar and initially think, why would I want to do it that way? Picture this, you've been driving your car the same way forever, right? Wheel, pedal, the usual stuff. Then one day your buddy pulls up and goes,
dude, do you want to go try my new ride? It uses a gamepad instead of a steering wheel.
And you're like,
a gamepad? Really?
Sounds ridiculous. Why mess with something that works? But you hop in, put your hands on, feeling totally awkward, but then you think, huh. You fly around corners, feeling more controlled than ever, and suddenly you're thinking, this is kind of actually awesome? That got me thinking about something we do every day, Git. Everyone uses it, right? But what if I told you there's a better way? Built in Google, recommended by industry geniuses like Scott Chacon, founder of GitHub, and Michel Hashimoto, founder of Hashicorp, which is also the creator of the amazing Ghostty terminal. Something that even Linus, yeah, this Linus, the actual creator of Git, officially acknowledged its strength and how it addresses some of the limitations of Git. JJ, or Jujutsu, might not only improve everyone's workflow, it'll also change how we think about version control, and trust me, you want to see this one. Not sure how I dared not to mention it, but JJ is written in Rust, and therefore you can cargo install it if you like. I'm not that cool, and on my Mac, brew install does the trick. And since at this point I'm expected to say it, it's available through Nix at jjvcs/jj on GitHub. Good, with JJ installed, it's available to us, but now what? Let's start with the simplest Hello World project. As if Git doesn't exist on a brand new project directory. A small go long app is enough to get started. I'll also create a go module so that the Vim LSP doesn't try to murder me every time I view the file and the app runs, so here we go. JJ git init initiates a new Jujutsu based repo. Yes, it used git in the command, and if you're like me, asking why not JJ init, here's the deal. At least what I make of it. JJ is like a client to a system that uses Git as a database. At this point, JJ is still backed by Git, and for a good reason. Let me show you. Instead of a .git, there's a .jj that's slightly different. It holds a working copy with a state and a bunch of other files. The repo holds a state of operations and other storage information. The first command we're looking at is jjst or git status, which comes up with files added, indicated by a next to them, a parent root commit, which is how JJ repos start, and a working copy commit with a few interesting details. Unlike Git, JJ has no index. What? Yes, don't go away, it'll all make sense. To those of you unfamiliar with Git's index, also known as a staging area where stage files are committed and vice versa, well, JJ, in a way, has everything staged. It sounds weird, in just a moment you'll see why it makes perfect sense. Back to JJ status, each line has a series of characters. This is what JJ tracks as a change, and next to it, a more familiar hash which indicates a commit, just like the one you're used to. We'll talk about why these differ and why we need both, but for that, we need to make some changes, right? JJ as is a short form of JJ log and the most useful command in the system. It'll show the same entries in the status, but add a timestamp, and more importantly, identifiers next to it. The most important of which is the @ sign, indicating the change we're currently editing. Before making a change and evolving the repo, I'll mention how an auto-completion is your best friend with not only JJ but any system. This is Carapace giving me a fuzzy finder with easy descriptions, which is extremely useful. It finds commands and their short form if these exist, and JJ devs were kind enough to produce them for useful subcommands. Now let's say I'm ready with my changes, or more precisely, ready to give them a proper description. This is done with JJ describe and can be done more than once on the same change. Giving a description doesn't mean we're done, it just means we have a good description for it. Makes sense, right? We can either provide the message with -m or avoid it and use the internal editor. And you'll notice we've been given pico, which is an absolute blasphemy. Making sure the nvar editor is set to nvim fixes this. Now we can describe the change and save. You'll notice that similar to git, JJ asks me to identify with a name and an email, which I'll happily do. That's it. JJ now opens the log with the change using my email and description, but you'll probably notice the @ sign still saying we're editing the same change, and that's no accident. A commit, or change, as JJ calls them, is an ongoing, dynamic, ever-evolving creation. Let me say this again. A change doesn't have an end of its own, but rather it ends when a new change starts. Confusing, I know, so let's do it. JJ new starts a new change, and now the at sign moved. You'll notice that the previous change ID on the working copy above is now at the parent commit, also addressable by at dash. And now there's a new change, currently empty and has no description. The status shows no changes in the working copy, so let's make some. Adding a small comment shows up in the status as a modification indicated by M. A new unfamiliar file will always show up as a change that's added with an A next to it. In Git, it would be an untracked file, but in JJ, it's a change like any other. Creating another new change works even though the previous one has no description. And that's a typical concept in JJ. It lets you work even when it's not ideal. Before making fixes backwards, here's a mind-blowing concept. JJ comes with undo. Yes, undo the last change, and voila, we're back to the previous change. You may have noticed that the changes have their first character colored. That's because JJ makes it easy for you to address them without providing the entire ID. Another sweet and thoughtful addition. Hey, super quick message. This video isn't sponsored by anyone, so why don't I sponsor myself? Gotta pay the bills. I have two workshops you'll find in the description. One is around building a second brain with NeoVim and Obsidian, and the other is Quick Start Kubernetes Workshop for people who don't have the time but do want to get their hands dirty and figure out what everyone's talking about. That's it. Thank you. Back to the video. Now, let's describe this change real quick and add another commit. Remember, a change in JJ is a dynamic creation and doesn't end when we describe it. Describing it again opens the editor with a current message that can be changed and saved. We can also provide the message while starting a new change with dash m. Now let's make another commit under the another change message, but feels like it could have worked just fine with a previous description, and there's no reason to add another change to the tree. JJ squash does exactly that, combines the changes and their message. Once saved, something interesting has happened. First off, both changes were combined into one, and you might notice that while the change stayed the same, the commit hash changed as well as the timestamp, indicating this is a different atomic commit. Not only that, there's a new change automatically started on top, which we're currently at. The even cooler thing about squash is that it doesn't have to address an existing change. If I just add another comment to main.go, no description, no nothing, I can go JJ squash main.go, and specifically main.go changes will be pushed down to the parent commit. Again, keeping the change ID, but recreating the commit hash. Crazy, isn't it? Just to confirm it worked, the status confirms the working copy has no changes, and the top of main.go does in fact has the fourth comment made earlier. I had to check multiple times to believe my own eyes. Just to show how fancy JJ can get, squash-i pops an interactive session where you can literally pick files and even hunks of code squash down if you want them. Here's another gem. If you don't like the current change, you can always abandon it, effectively making JJ reset the working copy and create a new change for you to work on. No messing about with reset commands, soft or hard, using the head or counting commits with the log. So we can init, describe, create new changes, undo them, and abandon working copies. But we're just getting started. The next bit is JJ's real power over Git, and here's the heart of the difference and what makes JJ so powerful, in my opinion. Let's create a new change and give it a descriptive name. I'll literally add code that prints something else and confirms it. I'll create a new change on top, this time with an empty string. Now, what if I kept working but realized I actually wanted to make additional modifications to my previous change? There's a few ways to travel back in time with JJ. The first of which is rather straightforward. Let's create a new change, but with dash capital B, tell it to go before. Before what? In this instance, before the current change, which doesn't have to be the one on top. I'll give it a description, and interestingly enough, JJ says it has rebased one descendant commit. Why? Because it pushed a change before the current edited one, so it had to rebase the changes on top. If you're confused still, this is the deal. We created a new change before the one we're working on, and it is automatically rebased our original change. How's that possible? What if there are conflicts? You're right to question this, but we'll get there. All I'll say is something that's probably hard to believe. This rebase will always succeed. I know it sounds ridiculous to some, but trust me, you're going to love it. Let's delete most of the commits in my file. Now, what if I still want to make changes to an earlier entry, not necessarily the last? Remember those colored first characters of the change IDs? Let's use them with JJ's most powerful move. JJ edit in an ID, or its colored first character, in this instance V, will throw us back to it. As evidence, main.go is empty, printing hello world, zero comments on top. JJ next dash dash edit moves us to the next edit on the tree. Look at the at sign showing we've moved from ID starting with V and now we're at W, where we added a comment. We can keep going down the list until we reach the current working copy. This could have been done with a direct edit, of course, but shows the power of JJ and how you can literally traverse through changes, finding bugs or introducing changes and having JJ rebase them for you. Now let's address the elephant in the room. We haven't talked about branches. JJ doesn't really use them, which at first sounds like crazy talk. You can think of them as anonymous branches, or my preference, call this a branchless workflow. Here's another head scratcher. It turns out you don't really need to name your branches. Rumor has it that Meta has been doing that for years with their own system. Comment below if you can confirm that. Anyway, Git is built around branches, but JJ sees the world differently. Consider this tree. Branches are just changes stemming from different parents. We don't need to give them names as long as we're describing the changes. To branch out in JJ, you run JJ new with a reference to a different change than the one we're at. That's pretty much it. JJ new Y creates a new working copy where the parent is the remove most comments change. Looking at the log shows a visual branch out of what we've just done, so it's easier to track later when we decide to merge paths again. I'll make a quick comment to note the branch change. Now when I describe it, I end up with a fork in the road that's described by the change. When I want to go back to the other branch, JJ edit its last change puts me right there. Here's main.go untouched, and I'll add another function rather than a comment so that things are easy to track later. Since JJ doesn't have branches as first class citizens, and these are just anonymous branches stemming out from different places, to list branches, we can use the log and use a combo of two internal functions, heads and all. These functions are called rev sets or revision sets, and they allow us to cover a range of commits. It is cool to cover, but it's out of the scope for this video. Comment below if you want me to nerd out further about these, but I think it's time to put branches right where they belong, in a merge. To make things easy, I'll use the limit flag of the log command. With both branch tips visible, we want to merge them into one. You'd think that JJ merge does the trick, and that's not the case. All you need to do to merge two paths is to create a new change using two parents. So, JJ new X and ZY with a message, and we have a new change, merge and ready for work. This is actually more powerful than what you'd think. In JJ, you can add as many parents as you like. We can add three different branched parents and combine them into one new working copy. Looking at main go, we have both the branched out comment and the additional function both merged successfully. You see what happened there? JJ just eliminated the need for an entire command. Are you starting to question life now and why you've been merging and rebasing in Git since you can remember? JJ actually does have a rebase command to instruct the system to do just that, put a change on top of another. Let's do exactly that. Using the famous undo command, we get rid of the merge in one simple go. This can be actually done again to undo the undo. So here's the merge again, in case you were worried. Anyway, back to the branch, let's rebase one end on top of the other. Rebase dash S for source and the change ID, dash D and destination to rebase on. And poof, rebased one commit onto destination X. The tree is now flat, but do note that we're at change X, as we were earlier, not on top of the rebase change. We'll use a nice trick for that and run edit with the at sign and plus, sending us to the child commit of where we're at. Before we wrap things up, let's see how JJ beautifully handles with conflicts. We'll do that by removing the function called another, then by creating a new change that's described as adding a third function stemming from the change starting with O. We create a branch. Now here's the previous version of main go, where instead of removing the second function, we'll actually add a third. This will definitely create a conflict, forcing JJ to come up with a solution. Okay, ready? JJ rebase using XSV as source and ZV as destination. And here we are. There's a new conflict, But what's more interesting is that the rebase went through. Wait, what? That's right. In JJ, rebase always succeeds. Conflicts or not, you're not stuck. The log will show a conflict, and as earlier, we're at the source of the rebase, so it's time to resolve the conflict. We'll use the edit at plus, where we're told it's a two-sided conflict. Main Go shows a rather familiar side with markers pointing the changes and where they come from. So we fix them, save, and that's it. We've resolved everything, but I promised to do it with style. So JJ comes with a resolve command. This pops an interactive interface where we can find conflicted files. In this instance, there's only one, so picking it expands the changes and we can pick what goes in and what stays out. And yes, the mouse is also available here should you need it. Upon saving, JJ says existing conflicts were resolved or abandoned and we can keep working. So we close the loop of having a new repo, making changes, going back in time, branching out, merging, rebasing, and having everything we need to get cracking with Jujutsu as your version control. I hope JJ left its impression on you, and even if not completely, I recommend giving it a small chance. The thing about code version control is mastering the basics, but also making sure that these are ingrained into your daily workflow, at least for basic operations like staging, committing, and pushing. Here are my top recommendations for the complete workflow for using Git daily. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.